Hey, I have a cold. I'm aware I sound terrible. I'll try to keep this quick. But I recorded this video last week, and since then, Totally Not Mark, another content creator on YouTube who makes a lot of one-piece content, has had this terrible thing happen where Toei, the animation studio in charge of One Piece and a lot of other animes, has made some false claims on his channel, on his content, and over 150 videos have been taken down because of it. It's been devastating for his channel. And if you are watching me, chances are you know who he is. You're aware of this because his channel is a lot bigger than mine is. But I wanted to be sure to put this in this video because it's been amazing to see how much the community has rallied around him and shown their support. And if there's any chance that anybody is watching this that hasn't seen his videos, I'm gonna have his video pinned in the comments of this video. Please go check it out and show your support for him. I will continue to read One Piece and to make One Piece content, but there will be no anime clips in my videos, which there were very rarely clips anyway, but that's definitely not something I'm messing with because Mark is a great guy as far as I can tell, and what's happening to him is truly, truly devastating. So please go check out his video if you haven't and show him some support. Sorry for my voice. On to the video.
Okay, so I'm back. So I took most of November off from posting videos. If you missed my video explaining why I was taking a break, I'll link it in the corner and down in the description for you to check out if you didn't see it before. But the short version of it is that our adoption was completed. We were able to go get our daughter and bring her home. So she's now home. I'm now a mom of two. She's amazing and adjusting wonderfully. She is so happy and silly and wild. And she and Drennan, my son, are having the best time. They are such great pals so quickly. But this video is going to be about Whole Cake Island, specifically the first third of it. I'm breaking this video up into three parts, just like I did with Dressrosa. And I have read at this point up through 851, chapter 851. So that's the amount of knowledge that I have, and I have a lot of emotions too. But before we get into all that, shout out to today's sponsor, Wraithmarked Creative. Specifically, right now, they're promoting a web series novel called Mother of Learning. This is kind of like an in-between between manga and novels, at least that's the way I think of it, because it was published serially, chapter by chapter, but it is in novel format. And it is the number one most highly rated and most popular web series on Royal Road. And the quick synopsis of it is that there is a teenager going off to his magical school, trying to keep his head down, work hard, but then he gets stuck in a time loop. And the time loop isn't intended for his purposes, so he kind of has to solve the mystery of why he's here and what's going on here. Right now, the edited version of the first three arcs in the series are available in ebook, and in 2022, paperback and hardback will be available as well. Information is down in the description if you want to check it out. So, Whole Cake Island. I love it so much already. I mentioned it already in the last arc that I love the setup of what we're doing here. It's such a trope, which is not a negative thing inherently, obviously, because I'm about to say negative things about it, but it's a commonplace, at least in novels. I'm still relatively new to manga, but at least in novels, it's a commonplace trope to have this, you know, arranged marriage, fighting against fate. I want my freedom, but I'm being forced to, you know, marry into this royal family because I'm royalty and woe is me. And like this baseline setup is so tired in literature, and people are so tired of it, but I love it so much. So I was so excited to get this, you know, the very base of what we're doing plot-wise, but Oda. And I'm enjoying what he's doing with it so much. There's so many trademark things that he's already bringing into this stuff that I just don't get tired of. Like, this setting is awesome. I love Whole Cake Island so far. It's so whimsical and dreamy and joyful and fun on the surface, which is such a typical Oda setting. He loves his, you know, it looks like this on the surface, but once you get down deep, there's seedy under, you know, there's stuff going on underground that's very dark, right? He loves that. I love it too. I don't get tired of it. And I love this concept of this singing, happy, joyful island. And the idea of Mom is that she wants to have all races be able to live in harmony amongst themselves, which is so cool because that fits with the themes of One Piece so well. For the heroes, races living in harmony, races trying to have equality is such a reoccurring theme in One Piece for the good guys. The bad guys are usually trying to prevent that. Then we have Mom come in, a character that I still don't really know that much about. I mean, I have little snippets of knowledge on her, but I don't know her that well at this point. She comes in, and her goal for this island, or at least what I'm told is her goal for this island, is something in line with the themes for the good guys, for what this, what Oda is saying, hey guys, this is good, racism bad, living in harmony and respecting one another good, right? Like, he talks about this a decent amount. Fishman Island is a really big one, and so is Arlong Park, and it comes up a lot. And then we have Big Mom, who we know so far as this tyrannical leader. We know so far as somebody who rules with an iron fist, who took over the ruling, I don't know, she was over Fishman Island, and they were having to produce all these sweets, and whenever Luffy ate them, you know, like, we see little snippets of her, and she doesn't look good to us. And even the way Oda drew her, she has this very ominous and unsettling and domineering presence, right? The way Oda drew her makes you inclined to think, oh, this is a powerful force. Then we get little snippets of her, like when she has her hunger pains and she kills one of her own by blood children because she's just in a rage. And we learn that she is, for every 6 months you live on the island, you have to surrender a month of your lifespan. Is that correct? So for every 6 years you live there, you lose a year of your life. Did I remember that right? Anyway, we learn about all these things that she does, and she can steal the soul, steal the lifespan, essentially, of people, and then she takes that and she puts it in her world, and that's what makes this world so animated and jolly, which is so disturbing now. These animated things that were singing and happy and made this place feel so fun, now I know is stolen life. Sometimes surrendered life, sometimes stolen life. So she's not cool, right? Yet her goal for this island is in line with the themes of this arc that Oda is pushing. But we also know that she traps the most unique creatures that she finds in the world in a book to flip through, and she has them in prison. She's so interesting to me because there's things about her that make me go, why are you fighting for equality if you're a good guy? That's not what Oda does. Oda does make his bad guys very layered and nuanced and have nuanced motivations, but he doesn't do this, unless I just have forgotten everything in my break. But you're obviously not cool. Anyway, we're still just in the setup. I haven't even started talking about Sanji. The setup of this arc is phenomenal. I don't even know what to do with it, and I'm a third of the way through the arc, and I still feel like I barely know anything about Mom, and I can't wait to learn more about her. I'm loving this world, I'm loving this setting, I'm loving the basic plotline that we have set up for Sanji, and so far I'm loving what Oda is doing with it for the most part. It's just going really well for me. So let's actually get into let's discuss the moment. Sorry, I'm already out of practice. Bear with me. We start off this arc with Luffy being Luffy and catching a poisoned fish, and then immediately, what does he do? Lick the skin? There's some weird slime here. Let's eat. It's Luffy. It's Luffy. He should have died instantly, but because he has a wonderful tolerance for poison because of the life that he has lived, he's not dead just quite yet. So I like this because I like that Oda enters arcs with the crew. He enters arcs by just having some silly, fun, goofy crew moments, and I don't get tired of that. But then very quickly he introduces some of the main antagonists, some of the main conflicting characters of this arc so far that I've read, but he introduces them in a way that very clearly establishes what kind of people they are, starting with Yanji? Is his name maybe? One of the brothers. Starting with him showing up and refusing to help even though he could, and then Sister coming in and sucking the poison out of him. And we very quickly learn what kind of siblings and family Sanji is coming from, as well as seeing a really important level of his sister where she goes along with them and she participates with them, but there's definitely, she's not just simply bad like her father and brothers are. She has compassion and she is actually, I really like her character. I still don't fully know where to put her, but Oda doesn't tend to like to put characters in good and evil exclusively. I mean, he definitely does it sometimes, but there are definitely characters that are just strictly gray, and so far that's how I'm feeling about her. She's kind of in a position where she feels like she has to go along with the family, otherwise she'll be treated the same way that Sanji was, but at the same time she has some core goodness in her. I also find it really interesting that she was born before the four boys, yet her number is zero, which makes me wonder if Sanji's dad had repeatedly had, or parents, had repeatedly had girls, how would he have numbered them? Like, if he had three girls before he had his four boys, then would they be named 0, 00, 000? How would he have named them? Anyway, super quickly into the arc, Luffy and Chopper do what Luffy and Chopper are good at, which is leave the ship and cause dismay to someone who wants to be inconspicuous. They fail to be inconspicuous by eating an entire building. And then Pudding shows up and saves the day. Now let me tell you something. If I had stopped just a couple chapters earlier, this review would have looked really differently. Because I fell for Pudding so hard. I wanted her to join the crew. I wanted Luffy to go ahead and make the room for her so that Sanji and she could be, live happily married together as a part of the crew. She was so charming and adorable and sweet. And I am a very suspicious reader. I tend to read into a lot, and sometimes that does well for me because it's Oda, and sometimes I read way too far into things that should just be dropped. I did not suspect Pudding for a second, and I spent the majority of my reading of this section of the arc gushing over how much I love her and how I was going to steal her from Sanji and marry her myself. And I don't know, I still kind of feel really betrayed. I think I feel more betrayed than Sanji does at this point. No, I'm being dramatic. Of course I don't. But also, I'm gonna talk about her as if she hasn't hurt me until we get to the end of this. Pudding was so adorable and helpful and adorable and so incredibly cute. The way she was so shy and bashful and how she loved Sanji but didn't want to admit it, and she wanted to marry him and he wanted to marry her, but she was gonna give him up and just hope that the next guy might be better, accept her fate, but not want to force Sanji into a marriage with her. I fell for it so hard. And I still just feel really, really betrayed. We'll talk about it when it's time. I really loved her. Pedro is super sus to me. I really, really like his vibe a lot. I like how intense he is, how he's always ready to fight, how there's that one scene when they were telling Pudding, don't worry, no one's gonna hurt you. And then Pedro has her with a knife to her throat and he's like, should I kill her? Like, I love his general demeanor, but I'm super suspicious of him. Again, I'm a very suspicious reader, so this may be nothing, but I am. There was that one scene where that one wolf guy came up to him and he was like, Captain Pedro, haven't seen you in ages. And he's all shush, shush. He's like, I'll tell you about it later. When Pockums, the lion turtle, disappears, and it says, on the mirror, it says, turn back. And I really doubt that Pockums got kidnapped, but had time to carve that into the mirror. I think Pedro probably, like, betrayed him and carved it in as a sign to the people. I don't know. I don't really have any good reason to think that, other than there are just a couple of little things that have made him suspicious to me. I'll talk about more in a little bit. Anyway, we get a flash of the other brothers. Oda does a great job of introducing them as well, very briefly showing us that they're not cool. And then we get to Mom's hunger pains and Jinbei coming in and solving that. And then asking for his freedom. So I really, really, really love this scene. I love Jinbei an unreasonable amount. No, it is reasonable. He has earned all my love. And I love the scene where he's back on Fishman Island and he's telling them, I really want to join Luffy's crew. I hope you guys will support me in this. I think that it would be beneficial to everybody if I could join his crew. And their response to him, he left Neptune's army to be a pirate so he could fight alongside the former slaves. He took a warlord position to help raise the standing of the fishmen. He sheltered under the protection of the Big Mom pirates to ensure the safety of the fishmen and to protect their kingdom. All his choices have been for others, and now they want him to live his life. Oh, man. Fishman Island was such a parallel to Nami's story in Arlong Park in so many ways. And I really love how Oda just continues those parallels and continues to draw us back, associating those two together so closely. And with the scene in and of itself, it's a great scene for the fishmen in general and for Jinbei as well, but also it's so great because it's such a parallel to Nami when she gave her entire life, where she, all of her major life decisions were done for her village, for her people who were enslaved by Arlong and his pirates. And in the end of her arc, when they told her, go be free, go live your life, you've made every decision for us, thank you. Now go. And that's what the fishermen are doing for Jinbei when he's given up so much and made so many major life decisions for them. And now he wants to join the Straw Hats and his people tell him, go, you've given us so much. It's time to live your life for you. And I just, oh, I love it so much. So then we're brought to Big Mom where he is requesting his freedom. Most people are killed just for even bringing it up, even for mentioning it, but Big Mom actually hears him out because Jinbei is Jinbei and apparently he's that powerful and cool. So she hears him out, but she tells him, you have to sacrifice something for me, and she spins the wheel. And to me, that wheel looked like she was going to take a limb from him, but there's something that happens later on in the arc that makes me think that those actually symbolize the amount of life that she's gonna take. I don't know, maybe I misinterpreted something. But anyway, Oda leaves us on a cliffhanger, as he does, and we don't know how that turns out just yet, but we do get a scene where there's, where people are reading the newspaper saying that Jinbei backed down. And Oda, you've done this to me too recently for me to fall for it. Again, maybe I'm about to look like a fool, but in Dressrosa, you did the same thing where Law told Doflamingo, you have to give up your warlord position. That's part of the deal that we're making. And Doflamingo said, yeah, sure, no problem. And then we got the papers announcing that he renounced his warlord position. But it was all a ruse. It was a political thing, not political. It was a, why can't I think of the word? It was a front. It was to trick Law. And I don't believe these papers. I mean, Big Mom is an emperor of the sea. Warlord of the sea. Emperor. She's one of the four emperors. I fully believe that she has the power to make the press say whatever she wants it to say. So maybe she gave Jinbei his freedom, but then she put out into her people, no, he backed down. I didn't let him go from my reign of terror. I'm not using the right words here. What is it? I let him denounce his service to me. He drank of the cups, like Luffy and Sabo and Ace. Yeah, Ace. Like Luffy and Sabo and Ace did. He drank of the cups for Mom. That's a really big, that's like a binding, they are now mother and son, and now he's asking out of that, and most people are killed just for asking it. So I think he did get out. He probably had to sacrifice some of his life. She probably took some of his soul. But then I think she did let him free because of some level of respect that she has for him, or who knows why, and then put it in the papers that she didn't let him free, that he backed down so that she could save face, so that people could still see, you can't get out of a binding contract with me. That's my theory around that. I should really break out the tinfoil hat again, shouldn't I? Anyway, back to Pedro. So Pedro used to be he used to serve as a pirate with Pokums, the lion turtle. And that time he tried to steal the glyph from, what did he try to steal from? Yeah, he's tried to steal it from Big Mom. It was gifted to Big Mom by Jinbei. He tried to steal it and failed, and he wanted to bring it back to Cat Viper, but he failed, and now he's back, and he's going to do it again. He's going to try again, and this time he's going to die trying for the Straw Hats, which, I'm not going to lie, also looks a little bit suspicious. I mean, maybe I'm dumb, but I don't see any really strong motivation for giving up your life to do that when it's not even going back to Cat Viper this time. It just seems like such an extreme devotion. I mean, I guess that they are technically the saviors of I can't even remember what it's called, of the Mink Island. So I guess he is pretty indebted to them. So now that I'm thinking about it, maybe it's not that suspicious. Maybe he's fine. Maybe he's just great and I'm being overly suspicious, because I really do like his character a lot, especially after we found out that his comrade took the eye of one of Mom's generals, I think it was, and then he had to take on part of his punishment and lost a lot of his life, and now he's planning on doing this mission, and he's planning on dying in the... You know, he is really great. Maybe I shouldn't be suspicious of him. Anyway, we're in the Seducing Woods. I really liked this section. This is when things get a little bit, you know, when everybody splits up and when it gets chaotic. All the copies being made, and Brulee? One of Mom's kids showing up, and she's awesome. I love her character design. I love her personality. I love her abilities. Her taking on the form of Luffy and tricking them, and then the real Luffy trying to round up all the different copies. Luffy fighting himself. Oh yeah, we meet Lola's dad, who's stuck in the ground and really likes apple juice. And of course, Carrot and Chopper. Carrot and Chopper end up getting trapped in the mirror world, which I love. The mirror world is so cool. I love how twisty and turny and chaotic it is. This really does feel like Alice in Wonderland. I don't know if this is supposed to be Alice in Wonderland. I think someone mentioned Hansel and Gretel as well when I mentioned Alice in Wonderland, and that makes sense. But it does. It feels so chaotic, and I love Alice in Wonderland. Anyway, going through the mirrors, and this big mirror world, and the mirrors are all connected, and you can travel the world through this mirror world, is so fun. And I love their little plot line, and I can't wait to see how that resolves. And I hope they stay in there a little bit longer, even though it wouldn't benefit anything if they did. But anyway, they get eaten up by mirrors, or trapped in mirrors, I know. And Luffy and Nami are on their own. And it's just chaos. And we also have a very serious fight with a gingerbread man. Now, at this point, I'm definitely going out of order of the sequence of how it's shown to me, but all this takes place in the Seducing Woods. I'm pretty sure the fight with the gingerbread man takes place in the Seducing Woods. All of this takes place in the same area, and it's all a part of what I consider a weaker, or weaker is wrong. The part of the arc that I didn't love quite as hard. Now, don't get me wrong, all of the things that I just mentioned were really fun, and the fight with the gingerbread man was fantastic. It was action-packed, it was great, it was well-drawn, it was well-done. All of Oda's fights are good, but, and it was a really good relief from all of the emotional stuff that's happening, because we did get all the Sanji stuff that I'm about to mention. We got it before this, and it was a good break from all the extreme emotions to just have a really fun, great fight scene. But the Seducing Woods, I think, was a really fun section, but I don't necessarily feel like I needed all of it or needed it all to last as long as it did. It added great moments of action and of humor, and a lot of it was really relevant to the story, but also a lot of it I just felt like I was ready to get back to the main emotional thread that we were really digging into. That said, one extremely important purpose that this served was, one, to show how strong, or to reinforce how strong Big Mom is, that Luffy, he is a really important part of her, like, he's higher up in her army, but regardless, not her, one of her people, Luffy had to fight for 11 hours straight before he finally won the battle, which is a big showcase for what we're up against, but also it made the scene when Luffy finally does see Sanji and go to him, and the Luffy versus Sanji chapter where he's fought so hard to get here. He's exhausted, he's beat down, he's worn out, I said that already with exhausted. He has gone so far to get to this moment, only to be rejected and beat down further. Man, it's intense. Another really significant moment for this gingerbread fight, in my opinion, is when Gingerbread says that Sanji is going to, or Sanji probably doesn't even want them and probably would reject them and say all these things. Sorry about that. My daughter needed me. We've only had her home for a very short time, and she still is adjusting. I mean, she's doing amazing, but she's still pretty clingy, so I can only film for a short period of time before she's like, where's Mom? So if anything is different here, or if this transition of thought isn't smooth, I'm sorry. Anyway, so one thing that I think is extremely significant about this fight here with Luffy and Gingy is when Gingerbread says all those things, which I've already said. When he says all those things, and Luffy's response is, no, Sanji would never speak to me like that. Even if he decides to stay and to leave the Straw Hats, he would never speak to me like that. And I think that this is a really significant moment that makes what's to come that much more impactful, because it shows Luffy knowing who Sanji is, knowing the kind of man that he is right from the jump. So when things do go down, and when this is fulfilled to an extent, and Luffy is staring it in the face, he's still able to stand on, I know who Sanji is. Which I'll get to when we get to that. I'm really doing things out of order now, but I wanted to point that out, or put that here for some reason. I don't actually know why. Let's reverse now, and let's talk about Sanji. Sanji's had some amazing moments with Pudding up to this point, between him genuinely falling for her, she's so sweet, and she's so freaking genuine seeming, and the fact that that I believed that she really loved him and really cared for him and told him, you know, I'm not gonna force you into this, and I'm gonna help you find a way out, and him realizing that he doesn't have a choice, and at first saying, no, I have to be with my crew, and then saying, well, at least I'm with someone that I care about. And, you know, he's been through so much with Pudding and built up so much genuine affection for her, which, to be fair, Sanji falls in love with every attractive woman that he meets, but this really is distinctly different. There's something very different about how Sanji feels about Pudding. It's, to me, I think that if he met her, this version of her in the wild, not under these circumstances, he would still have what is more than just, she's hot, let me simp, but something that's a lot stronger and something that would actually be long-lasting. I don't know. I just really think that there was something there, and I'm so pissed that it's just not real on her end. Anyway, we have all that going down, but then in the midst of that, we also have this fight with Sanji and his dad. Now, this is so incredible. I don't even know how to break this down, so forgive me because I'm probably going to do a poor job. But the back and forth that we get between the now Sanji and his dad facing off, and Sanji not being a match for his dad, but at least holding his own somewhat, as well as those flashbacks of seeing how his brothers treated him growing up, and seeing how he, when he went through these testings, we find out that his dad is, you know, able to do this genetic modification, and it worked on all the kids but Sanji. Sanji's just human. So seeing him fall behind in all of the testing that they do growing up, and him having a truly tender heart as a child, and how that is looked down upon and considered a weakness in this family, the way that his dad prefers his kids and loves on his kids, everybody but Sanji, the stark contrast between how he treats Sanji's siblings versus how he treats Sanji, and the horrible way that his siblings treat him. This fight in the present timeline as well is so hard to see, especially knowing where Sanji comes from and all he went through as a kid, and how he's already been beaten down so much by these people. And now he's in a position where he's forced to be in their presence again, the people who've called him a failure and who have rejected him and beat him down for so much of his life, and that he escaped from, and now he's forced to be with them again, and now he has to stand up to them and fight them. You know, this is just, it's such emotional stuff. And then at the end of this fight, where Sanji loses and he has these bracelets put on him where it's what the toe jams use when they put the collar on people. And, you know, there's a lot here to unpack, but the fact that his dad calls him a failure, says that he didn't want to sacrifice one of his children for this marriage alliance, but then he remembered, I have a failure. I have a reject that I can dispose of for these purposes. You know, the fact that he gets beat down so much physically and emotionally, but then at the end, having these put on his hands, which are extremely valuable to him, but what it is the symbol of a slave, the symbol of someone who's being passed off, the symbol of someone who's being sold away, who's worthless, who's just an exchange of goods. You know, the symbolism of his father using that method to keep him there is just, to me, it speaks so loudly of what his dad really thinks of him in actions and not just in words. Oh yeah, also Lion Turtle got shot, which I don't think he's dead. It was just one little scene. His character hasn't done enough yet to where he can die at this point. So I think it's another fake out death. Oh yeah, so then we have this scene with Big Mom and with Caesar where she's reminding him, hey, I've pumped you full of a whole lot of money, a whole lot of opportunity to do this thing that I want, to turn me into a giant, to turn my family into giants, because it's the one thing that I'm missing. So you didn't complete the work, even though you kept telling me that you were close, and we know that Caesar was lying the whole time and instead just using all the money for his own gains under the protection of Doflamingo, and he was basically swindling one of the four emperors. You dum-dum. I love his gall. But anyway, then she tells him, I have a lab. I've basically recreated Punk Hazard Lab for you. Do what I want you to do. So Caesar's in a conundrum. That'll be fun to see it'll be fun to see how that turns out. Oh yeah, we find out that Nami the Vivri card? I don't actually know how to pronounce this. The life card, the this is how you can find me easily card that Lola gave to Nami back in the Gothic arc. What was it called? Thriller Bark, back in Thriller Bark. The card that Lola gave to Nami back in Thriller Bark. Turns out it's Big Mom's, and so we have a way to find her as well as to quell the homies, which is just extraordinarily convenient, and I'm interested to see how Oda makes this cohesive, because at this point, I mean, sure, it took a ton of pre-planning to set that up way back then, but also it's just so extremely convenient. And also I'm curious because there is a line where it says that even Mom's kids are forbidden from even touching one of her Vivri cards. So why did Lola have one? I wonder if her dad had it because he was one of her husbands. And maybe he knew that he was going to be rejected, pushed aside. And so he gave it to his daughter for who knows what reason. And then she gave it to Nami for really why? Why did she do it other than, hey, we're sisters now. Here's something I'm not allowed to have. You don't know my mom, and I don't know if you'll ever come in contact with her, but here you go. She'll probably be nice to you if you have this card that I myself am not allowed to have. Or even allowed to touch. And also my mom kills her own children when she has hunger pains. I mean, it just right now it doesn't feel smooth. Right now I don't really understand it, so I'm waiting to see Oda make it work. So anyway, after the fight, we then have Sanji having dinner with his family, and snobby brother insults the food, doesn't want to finish it, and then throws a plate of food at the cook, which basically enacts all of Sanji's instincts of you have offended me. Now, Sanji, I love that Sanji's a gentleman, and I love that he has a deep respect for women when he's not, you know, being a perv. But I do have kind of mixed feelings about this side of him because it is so over the top and extravagant that there are times where I'm like, you know, let her stand on her own. You don't have to always be right there. But this is such a great scene for Sanji, such an amazing scene for Sanji where he stops the plate and stands in between his brother and her, and then eats the food off the floor and compliments her cooking. And you know, this is something that he's really passionate about, and you know that his compliments are so sincere, and taking that moment to stop her from being assaulted and then to tell her that she's done an excellent job is so, it's such a good moment for him. It's such a quiet, good moment for him. But unfortunately, because his family is horrible, this leads to her being beaten so badly as a way to put her in her place, but also I think as a way to put Sanji in his place too. How dare you stand up to me? You're worthless. So anything you care about will also be worthless. Which leads Sanji to go after his brother and find that they are growing humans, growing people to be their army, to essentially be bodies to fight and to die for them. And all of this is possible because Dad used to work with Vegapunk before Vegapunk was taken in by the military, yeah? Anyway, speaking of Dad, one thing that I forgot to mention is that the bracelets are not the only thing that he's holding against Sanji. He also is threatening Crap Geezer. Speaking of Crap Geezer, back to flashbacks. One incredible moment from Sanji's childhood flashbacks is seeing him make food for his mom. He's passionate about food as a youngster, making food for mice and studying cooking. And I did see that the Book of the Devil Fruits, which is probably how he learned about the clear, clear fruit, mentioned back way back. I mean, I only saw it because of the SBS, but I saw it. But something's up with his mom. Something is up with his mom. I don't know what yet, but he was cooking for her. He dropped the food. It was terrible. It was a mess. And she still ate it and asked him to cook for her again. And honestly, this moment is the most wholesome, sweet, wonderful moment. And I would love to learn more about his mom. Please. There's actually so many things in these brief flashbacks that we see that really shape who Sanji is as a person and where his morals come from and where his passions come from, choosing to feed anybody that needs it, his passion for cooking, as well as something that I haven't mentioned yet, but as well as his very dinosaur age ideas about protecting women and all that. We see where that all comes from. We see where a lot of who Sanji is stems from, the core of what started who he is and why he puts so much value on certain things in these flashbacks. And man, I appreciate that so much. Speaking of all that, back to the flashback of when Dad rejects Sanji and Sister sets him free, and then Dad sees him and says, "Ah, I'm a softy. I'll let you go. Just don't tell anyone that I'm your dad. I couldn't bear the embarrassment." And it's just so hard, like so many things from Sanji's childhood, watching him grow up and seeing the way he's treated by his family is so hard to read. And seeing this moment of his dad, who's already rejected him, already called him a failure, already imprisoned him, seeing him say, "I can't kill you, but I can't bear for the world to know that you come from me." That is so messed up. I mean, it's all messed up, but gosh, but then we get to see that in contrast of Crap Geezer when he took him in and seeing him. What did he say? Hang on. "If you ever set foot off the path of a proper man, I'll cut off your balls and slit my own throat." That is so dramatic. I just want to say that is so dramatic. But then when Sanji asked why, and he says, "Because that's how a parent owns up to his mistake." That contrast of seeing his dad say, "I can't bear for the world to know that I'm your parent." And then you've got Crap Geezer who, without invitation, has taken him in as his son and called Sanji his own. I mean, no wonder Sanji was so loyal to him. No wonder Sanji loved him so dearly. I'll also mention, I'm jumping around so poorly, so much, I'm really sorry, guys. But I'll also mention this scene when his sister does set him free from jail. I can't help but notice what she says to him. "The sea is a huge place. Someday you'll find people who are good to you. Now run and don't turn back." It reminds me so much of what Saul said to Robin when he sacrificed himself to let her go free. All right, we're caught up with the Sanji stuff. Now let's talk about the big moment. So Luffy, having fought for 11 hours, having gone through so much to get to Sanji, having believe with all of his heart that Sanji does want to join back up with them, and if he doesn't, that he'll at least never speak to them the way that Jinji said that he would. And then we get to this moment with Luffy being so excited, rushing up to Sanji's carriage and saying, "We came to get you, Sanji." And man, the joy on his face. And I hate this trope. Y'all know I hate this trope. I made that very, very clear. When Luffy came to rescue Ace, he went through all that he did to rescue him, and then Ace says, "What are you doing? I have a family. You're not a part of it. Go home. I don't want you here." I hate this trope so much. This, "I'm hurting you so I can protect you. I don't want you to be in danger, so I'm going to break you down, beat you down, tell you that you're worthless and you mean nothing to me so that you'll leave me. I'm protecting you." I despise it. Now, I will say that in the instance of Ace, even though I hate the trope, I liked the way Oda handled it because Luffy didn't buy it. He instantly rejected that, said, "No, you don't. You do care about me. You do need my help. I know you're lying." And he barreled through and he continued to try to save his brother. I love, if you're gonna use this terrible, horrible trope, I love that Luffy at least is so emotionally mature that he doesn't buy it, that he's just like, "No, that's not who you are, and that's not who I am either." And in this moment, the story is unfinished where I am, so I could be proven wrong, but in this moment, it seems like Oda's doing the exact same thing, where Luffy knows who Sanji is, and he knows that Sanji would never speak to him like this. Sanji would never treat him this way. And so when Sanji says, what does he say? "Get lost, you miserable, inferior pirates." Luffy knows. It's not true. This isn't Sanji talking. Something's wrong here. And so he lets Sanji beat him down. He's tired. He's ragged. He's been through so much to get here. And what he gets is to get beaten by his crew member that he came to save. He takes it. He doesn't fight back. And then he says, "I'm not going to eat. I'm not going to move from this spot until you come back." And seeing the pain that Luffy has to endure in his friend harming him like this, and seeing Nami be so hurt and disappointed in Sanji's actions, man, it's a really incredible and horrible scene. Luffy being so broken, yet still so intense about not believing it. And then seeing Sanji drive away in the carriage, so broken for what he had to do, what he feels he had to do, because he's protecting his crewmates, he's protecting Pudding, he's protecting Crap Geezer. He doesn't have any choices, and he feels like this is his only option, and doing this to Luffy hurt him so bad. It's incredible. It is such an incredible chapter, and it's so painful. It also really reminds me of, you know, back in Enies Lobby when Usopp was also challenging Luffy and fighting Luffy and all that. But obviously, I think it's supposed to remind me of that. But really what it reminds me of the most is the role that Sanji played in that when Luffy and Usopp were fighting and Sanji kicked Luffy and said, "What are you doing? Don't say something you're gonna regret." And he tried to stop the fight between Usopp and Luffy when it was escalating, before it got to the physical confrontation. But when it was verbally escalating, he tried to stop it. And he didn't want Luffy to say something that he would regret to one of his crewmates. And then Sanji's put in a position where he feels like he has no choice but to say something that he deeply, deeply regrets to his captain. Like, man, that hurts. And then we have some amazing panels of Pudding and Sanji bonding, Pudding crying to him and saying, I wanted to set you free of this. I wanted to help you escape, but it's too late. It's not gonna work. So what I can give you is I promise that in this life of hell that you've had to live with your family, marriage with me will not be that. And then you have this really amazing moment of Luffy fighting and them hugging, and it's so beautiful, and I'm so mad looking back on it now because I was so swindled. I believed you, Pudding. I believed you so much. I had so many comments talking about wanting to defend her and wanting to protect her at all costs. And I'm worried about her. Don't help Sanji get free. Your mom killed one of your brothers because of hunger pains. She will kill you too. She happily said, "Let's kill Lola." You're not safe with her, Pudding. Run away with Sanji. Join our crew. And I was played. So anyway, daggum Pudding. Moving on. Luffy after everything that he went through with Sanji, he's now ambushed by a bunch of Mom's pirates. This is an incredible scene, and there's so many characters that I can't wait to get to know better, and I really, really, really hope I'm going to get to know them better, especially that lady with the hat. She's so cool. But one character we did get to know a little bit is Book Book Man. Are you freaking kidding me, Oda? You made a book book fruit, and it's so cool. I love it. There's so many incredible scenes with Brook in this little section yet that I haven't talked about, where Brook and Pedro go off and they try to get the glyph thingy for Luffy. And oh man, you know, Pedro has some really good scenes too. His sacrifice and him. I still am suspicious, but I feel bad about it because he's really, really cool. But anyway, Brook has some incredible scenes, like this one where he's taking people down, where Pedro is a distraction and then he comes in and he takes them down. We get the big reveal of talking to Sanji's sister and her revealing her whole master plan, and then she has the film fruit, so she's able to edit out that piece of information from her sister's mind because she's a villain, so she has to have a villainous monologue. And she reveals her third eye, and I didn't believe it. I was like, oh, this is Brulee or whatever impersonating her and pretending to be a bad guy to hurt Sanji. But no, my sweet, wonderful pudding would never do this. She's not bad. I didn't believe the villainous reveal because I trusted her so much. But then when we cut to Luffy in prison with Pudding and Pudding revealing herself to him, and I realize that the reason that Luffy is going frantic in this cell and ripping himself apart, trying to tear his own arms off to get to Sanji, the reason Luffy is in such a desperate state is because he knows. Because Pudding revealed herself to him too, because she's a villain and she has to have a villainous monologue. He knows who Pudding really is. He knows that she plans to kill Sanji and his family. He knows that Sanji is about to be in so much pain and danger, and he will do anything, including ripping himself apart, to get to her. And when I realized that that is why Luffy is so desperate, is when I realized that Pudding really did betray us. And I don't know, it hurt. I love a good betrayal plot. I love a good betrayal twist. I think that it's so fun. And the CP9 betrayal was brilliant. I didn't see it coming, and it was shocking, and it was exciting, and it changed everything. And I loved it. And the Violet betrayal was really cool until I realized that Oda wasn't gonna commit. And there was a reason he didn't commit, and I know people are going to be offended that I worded it that way, but I kind of stand by it. It would have been cooler if she would have actually betrayed them. But this one, as wonderfully as it was told, as phenomenally as this was done, you know, Pudding betrayed me too. And it really hurt. I really hate this. No, I don't. I love it. It was brilliant. But I feel really personally betrayed by this. And I don't know, I'm so mad at Pudding. I love her so much, and I'm so mad. I'm so mad that it was all a ruse, and that she's hurt Sanji this badly, that Sanji is left out in the rain crying. Actually, I'm just gonna put this here on the screen because it's not my thought, but one of my patrons pointed out the parallels between this and when Sanji was taken into the crew by Luffy. And it's such an incredible and painful parallel. And this scene of Sanji realizing that the woman that he loved and that the one shining spot in his life, you know, like, he's lost everything. He's back into the clutches of his abusers. He's had to not only leave his crew, but utterly harm his captain. And he knows it. He knows he had to do it. He knows how much he hurt someone that he loves deeply. And his freedoms are being taken from him. And the one shining thing that he had in his life, someone to love, and he's devoting his whole self to loving her and to making her happy, only to find that this is hell too. I don't know. That hurt. So you've got Carrot being potentially eaten, chaos happening in this area, Chopper smash. This is a great Chopper moment. I don't want to gloss over it, but there's just so much happening that I kind of feel like I want to, but I won't because this is an excellent Chopper moment. More amazing Brooke moments. I love this scene where he's facing off against Mom and he says, I just want to read this whole page to you because it's so good. The thing about Sanji is he's very kind-hearted, so I knew that he would not return to us, no matter what trap it is you've set for him. His kindness knows no bounds. Once he's made up his mind to sacrifice himself for someone, he will not change his ways. And our captain, meanwhile, is a man who always trusts in his beliefs when he acts. So whatever happens will be decided by them. She said, so you have nothing better to do than to copy a stone. Not quite. I am doing it so that if, in the worst case scenario, Sanji does not return with us, he will not need to kick himself for bringing us here because we will have gained something tremendous for our trouble. And then Mom says everyone might die, and Brooke says, young lady, what kind of idiot draws up plans with the expectation of dying? You know, Brooke's growing on me. I have a lot of qualms about him. He's a swordman. We already have a swordman. Although his new ghostly powers where he can exit his body is great. I don't think the pervy jokes are funny. The may I see your panties thing, I think, like, I get it. Brooke's been alone for so long. He's gone a bit mad and that is kind of supposed to reflect that a little bit of showing how his social skills have gone and how he's so out of touch with what's appropriate. But I even have qualms with that because there was one scene where Brooke first met someone and asked them, can I have a loan, immediately into meeting them. And if Oda would have leaned into that, if Oda would have leaned into Brooke constantly asking inappropriate, socially inappropriate questions upon meeting people, that would have been hilarious. But instead he just keeps reusing the panty thing and it's just like, it's just not that funny. There's a lot of things about Brooke that made me just not interested in him for a long time. But the more time I spend with him, the more I really, really love his character. He's so perceptive. There have been so many scenarios where he has paid attention to the people around him and understood them and known what is needed of him and then just filled that role. I could give you a list of things that pop into my head of where he's done that. And his humor, when he's not being a perv, is really, really funny. I don't know, he's really growing on me. But anyway, this moment right here, tops Brooke moment. I can't think of one that I have loved more than this entire page. It gives me chills. I love this moment for him. Carrot and Chopper are finding their way through the mirror world by realizing that the mirrors will tell them what they lead to, which is super convenient and awesome, and I love the mirror world so much. And finally, in the pits of despair, Jinbei arrives. Oh, my dear sweet Jinbei, I love him so much, and he is here. He's here to set Luffy and Nami free, and we're gonna go save Sanji. And I still have 2/3 of the arc left, so it's not gonna go smoothly, but I'm so happy that Jinbei is here. It's funny, if I would have stopped reading, so my patrons told me you can stop at this chapter or this chapter, and they would have stopped me at Luffy in the cell, but no pudding reveal yet, or after the pudding reveal. And it's so funny because if I had stopped right before the pudding reveal, this review would have been an absolute gush for her. I would have spent this entire time talking about how deeply I love her and how very worried I was for her safety, afraid that she wasn't gonna make it out of this alive, afraid of what Big Mom would do to her, afraid that she was gonna sacrifice herself for the crew or potentially just remove herself from the situation so that Sanji, there would be no bargaining chip anymore. I was so afraid for this character. And if I had stopped this review just a little bit earlier, it would have looked really, really different. I'm so mad. I'm so mad, but I'm so happy because it's so good. So anyway, that is what I've hit so far. This is a third of the review. You'll have two more for Whole Cake Island before I'm done with you. So look out for that, I suppose. It's good to be back. I love One Piece. Be sure to chat with me more in the comments. What are some things that I skipped over that you would like to continue talking about, or some things that I messed up or missed? Be sure to chat with me more about it in the comments. I post videos every Tuesday through Friday. I'll see you again soon. Bye.